Now, the Chinese Empire did face conquest by outside invaders a couple of times, but Chinese culture and social organization and the sheer mass of the Chinese population helped China to absorb and convert its conquerors. In 1271, the Mongol leader Kublai Khan, the grandson of Genghis Khan, defeated the Chinese army and established the Yuan dynasty, which lasted for 98 years until 1368. Although Genghis Khan had never completely conquered China himself, despite 65 years of trying, Kublai Khan's Yuan Empire was the first time that the Chinese people were ruled by foreigners. The Khan distrusted the Confucian officials a little bit, but he didn't completely replace them as regional administrators. Still, through the Yuan dynasty, China was exposed to foreign cultures, especially to the Islamic world, and their cartography and mathematics and astronomy and medicine and food and clothing. While at the same time, the West was exposed to Chinese culture and to Chinese technology in a very serious and lasting way. The Silk Road, the ancient trading route that connected China with Europe, had languished for several centuries under the Islamic Caliphate in the Middle East. It was reestablished in 1271 by Kublai Khan, and almost immediately the Venetian merchants Niccolo and Maffeo and Marco Polo visited Kublai Khan at his summer palace in Chengdu, which Westerners call Xanadu. The Mongol rulers also patronized China's new printing industry, which helped to spread the idea of movable type into Europe. Despite the fact that China's Mongol Yuan rulers abandoned many of their own traditions and adopted the ways of the Han Chinese people that they conquered, the ethnic Han majority continued to resent being ruled by foreigners. Along with exposure to foreign cultures, the Mongols' reopening of the Silk Road also brought foreign diseases to China. Bubonic plague, which became known as the Black Death when it entered Europe and killed a quarter of the European population in the middle of the 14th century, actually hit China first. The plague began in central Kyrgyzstan and killed up to 25 million people in China in the 1330s and 1340s. So it began about 15 years before it first arrived in Constantinople. As in Europe, famine and social chaos followed the plague when farmers failed to produce enough to feed the survivors. A young man named Zhu Yuanzhang, born during these plague years, watched his entire family die in the famines that swept through southern China in the 1340s. After taking refuge in a Buddhist monastery, Zhu was radicalized and joined local rebels when the monastery was destroyed by Yuan forces trying to contain a local insurrection. Zhu joined forces with a rebel army called the Red Turbans, and he rose quickly through the ranks. Zhu married the daughter of the founder of the Red Turbans and inherited his leadership position after eliminating several of his rival generals. In 1356, as a 28-year-old, Zhu conquered the ancient capital city of Nanjing and made it his base. A little more than a decade later, in 1368, Zhu led his troops north and chased the Yuans out of their capital of Khanbalik or Dadu. The Mongols retreated back into Mongolia, and Zhu claimed the mandate of heaven and declared himself the first emperor of the Ming or Brilliant Dynasty. Zhu Yuanzhang called himself the Hongwu Emperor, and he made Nanjing his capital. Hongwu means expansive and martial, as in he was expanding the emperor, and he was very warlike. Imperial titles like Hongwu relate to the reign of each emperor rather than to the emperor personally. They're declaring what they hope will be the nature of their particular rule. These titles are not the actual name of the emperor, but this is how the emperors are known in Chinese history. Hongwu ruled for 30 years, and he tried to return the empire to its ethnic Chinese roots. Hongwu issued a series of decrees abolishing Mongol clothing and requiring people to abandon their Mongol-influenced surnames that they had taken on in favor of traditional Han Chinese names. administration of the empire by Confucian scholars was fully reinstated, along with the elaborate system of civil service examinations. Remembering the loss of his family and the famines of his youth, which had partly been caused by the flooding of the Yangtze River, Hongwu promoted public works and infrastructure projects, including new dikes and irrigation systems to serve an agricultural system that was dominated by paddy rice. He organized the building or the repair of nearly 41,000 reservoirs, and he planted over 1 billion trees in his land reclamation program. The Mongols had tried to turn North China into something that more closely resembled the steppes of their home, and so they had cut down a lot of trees. Hongwu replanted. Hongwu distributed land to peasants and actually forced many to move to less populated areas. During his three-decade reign, China's population recovered from the plague and famine years and grew from 60 to 100 million. Hongwu had fought his way to prominence, partly by eliminating his rivals and by trusting really only his immediate family. But when his first son, the crown prince, died, Hongwu decided to leave his throne to his grandson, to the heir's son, rather than to another one of his own sons. Hongwu's grandson became emperor in 1398 at the age of 20, but his reign was very short. His uncle Zhu Di, the emperor's younger son, had been passed over for the imperial crown, but remained a prince of the northern territory around Dadu, where he was defending the north against a reinvasion by the Mongols. In 1402, Zhu Di took his army and marched south to Nanjing and overthrew his nephew, declaring himself the Yongle, or the Perpetual Happiness Emperor. Yongle then tried to erase the memory of this rebellion by purging a large number of the Confucian officials stationed in the capital of Nanjing, and he moved the seat of government to his home in Dadu, which he renamed Beijing. Because he didn't trust these Confucians, Yongle ruled through an extensive network of court eunuchs who formed his palace guard and his secret police. He repaired and reopened China's Grand Canal, the 1,104-mile waterway that linked the Yellow and the Yangtze rivers, and that enabled the new capital to receive rice shipments from the south, which was very important. Between 1406 and 1420, he also directed 100,000 artisans and over 1 million workers in building the Forbidden City in Beijing as a permanent imperial residence. So, before we move on, some questions for discussion. Firstly, what were the main positive and negative results of the Mongol conquest of China? And secondly, how did the early Ming emperors try to change the society that they ruled? Would you consider most of their changes positive or negative for the Chinese people?